So I'm a computational material scientist. Like Marta said, I'm in the theory and modeling group at the Center for Nanoscale Materials, which is a user facility within Argonne National Lab. So I'll be talking about some of our atomistic modeling efforts. And in particular, we focus on a technique called as molecular dynamic simulations. And so I'll be presenting some of our work on both the applied side and some of the method development that we do in terms of developing more efficient force fields for these molecular dynamic simulations, which will basically move towards predictive materials design. So the idea is that we will be able to make predictions using our simulation models, which would help guide the experiment. So I'll highlight a couple of examples in that regard. And I will also define what the term tribology means. It actually is something which is of immense interest, but even I was not very familiar with that term until a few tribologists actually came and then told me what its importance was and what were the stuff that they were doing. So if I were to actually classify the work that I do in terms of two broad areas, they are molecular conversion and transported interfaces. So we deal with the reactive interfaces. We try to understand the dynamical events, the bond formation and bond breakage events that take place across different interfaces. So as I'll point out, these interfaces are of broad importance in all kinds of energy technologies and all kinds of applications where you have materials that interact through these interfaces. And then the second broad area is in understanding what is the atomistic origin of some of the physical properties of these nanoscale materials. And so since I'm at the nano center, focus is a lot on either nanoscale interfaces or nanoscale materials. And so we have a new division director who actually came and said that, you know, nanotechnology has been around now for like 10, 15 years. And he believes that, you know, it is now high time that nanotechnology really delivered something. And so there's a lot of push towards theoretically guided experiments with an aim that, you know, we will be able to synthesize materials that will be relevant to applications that we currently are involved in. So what motivates the work is shown in this materials landscape. It's if you're a material scientist, you would be familiar with this kind of a plot. It's called an Ashby plot, which basically shows you two different properties of all the materials. And these properties are often in conflict with each other. So, you know, if you have a Young's modulus, which is basically a measure of how soft the material is, and you have density. So if these are the two axes, and if you look at these materials space, you would notice that there are void spaces, which basically mean that there are spaces in this materials landscape that are not populated. So if you want to search for a material that is has extreme hardness but is low density, you would not be able to actually find that material because that material does not exist. And likewise, if you actually look for something that is very dense but soft, you would not be able to find that. So the idea is to actually look at hybrid materials, which are basically combinations of these different materials, and then try to populate this materials landscape. And there are many applications. And so here it's an example of Young's modulus versus density, but this can be Young's modulus versus conductivity, electrical conductivity. So if you are interested in application like flexible electronics, you want a material that is very flexible, that is soft, but you also want it to be electrically conductive. Again, if you actually try to look at the kind of materials that can actually populate that landscape, you will find that, you know, there are very few materials, and one has to resort to these kind of hybrid materials to be able to get new materials that can actually populate that landscape. The other aspect is that there are all kinds of reactive interfaces that underpin most of the energy technologies. So if we take a lithium-ion battery, there's an electrode and electrolyte interface. And there are events which take place across these interfaces that are of broad interest. And those are critical to design these kind of batteries that we use. Again, tribology is basically science that governs friction. So any two sliding parts will experience the dissipation of mechanical energy into heat. And so that is what is tribology. And so tribologists are often looking at materials, lubricant materials that will help reduce this friction between the sliding parts. And as I will show you, it is, you know, we all drive cars and all the engines actually have several moving parts. And so from our cars to the wind turbines, there are all kinds of moving part assemblies which actually lose a lot of heat through friction. And this is a big energy problem which often was considered to be a very applied area. But now with the advent of the supercomputing resources and more efficient models, we are able to take a very close look at the atomistic scale phenomena that is actually taking place at these tribological interfaces. And in fact, we are able to now even design lubricants on the computer, and then those can be validated through the experiment. So that's what tribology is about. And I'll give two specific examples where I believe a combination of simulations and experiments have led to a breakthrough in the field of tribology. Then there are applications such as corrosion, which we all know is, again, very important. Materials degrade over time, and one needs to actually understand what are the degradation mechanisms of these materials, what are the conditions under which these materials are stable. And a lot of it actually happens at the nanoscale and at the interfaces. And so we need to know what are the underlying mechanisms that lead to the breakdown of these materials. And that's what corrosion is concerned about. And then catalysis, as we all know, is again a very interesting area. It's been around for a long time. People are always looking for new catalysts, whether it is generation of fuel, or as I will show, even in tribology, you can actually merge the two fields and then come up with new kinds of lubricants by using catalysis under extreme conditions. So catalysis, again, a very broad area where people are looking at interfaces and interfacial phenomena. And photovoltaics, again, is an application where the interfaces actually play a key role. Across different energy applications, you have reactive interfaces, and one needs to actually understand what is the dynamics of the various events that take place across these solid-liquid interfaces or the reactive interfaces. So these can be like chemical reaction or adsorption of different species that can lead to a lot of different structural changes, and these can be either changes in the defects, that is very small changes in the local lattice, or they can be changes in the composition or the morphology or the microstructure of the interface itself. And all of this will have a very strong effect on the functionality of these interfaces. And so we need to really understand what is happening at these atomistic scale or get a molecular view. If you have these kind of solid-liquid interfaces, again, the solvation dynamics is a very important aspect, and a lot of focus nowadays is on understanding what is happening to the liquid interface as well, which was mostly ignored in the past. People used to focus only on the solid interface, but now the dynamics of solvation is also gaining a lot of interest. And so, these are three areas where I'm personally interested in: batteries, corrosion, and tribology. And I will give some examples of the kind of interfaces that that we have been looking at. So from a point of view of energy storage, this is where we are currently in terms of the battery technologies. Now, we really want to get down this amount to somewhere here, which is like $2 per gallon kind of a thing. So we want to be competitive with oil. We need more efficient batteries. And a lot of effort is going on even at Argonne to actually develop new, more efficient kind of batteries. And I'm sure you people will be familiar with that kind of effort. The other area of interest is aqueous corrosion. And in terms of the cost to the U.S. economy, it's $1.1 trillion or 5% of the GDP actually is wasted through corrosion. And so a lot of material damage actually happens, which if we avert, could translate into huge savings. And so this is an area which, again, conventionally people would actually resort to dipping coupons in seawater and then finding out what is the difference in the weight over an extended period of time, say 6 months, and then they would actually find out what is the rate of corrosion. Nowadays, people are actually now moving with the advent of more advanced characterization techniques and computational methods. People are now trying to gain a fundamental understanding of what is really happening and getting an understanding of what is the rate of corrosion just or the lifetime of the materials just based on these kind of models that are built on these advanced characterization and guidance from simulations. So that's another area. Tribology, again, is the understanding of the friction phenomena. If we look at how many millions of barrels of oil are spent just to overcome the friction in oil, it's about 1.2 million. So there is a lot that is being wasted every day because of this friction between the moving parts in our engine. And we can gain a lot, and there are a lot that can be done in terms of developing new kinds of lubricants. And so just based on the existing technologies, if we can identify new kinds of materials, it would be translated into huge savings. And most of these involve reactive interfaces, and so the next generation energy technology would depend a lot on our understanding of how these interfaces operate. So what we do is to actually use mostly atomistic modeling. So we are in this nanometer to micron range, which is where most of the reaction and interfacial phenomena actually take place. And so we resort to techniques such as molecular dynamics and sometimes kinetic Monte Carlo. And we leverage the computational resources that are provided by ALCF. Some of these simulations, like I will point out, cannot be done on modest computing resources like the carbon cluster, which we have within the CNM. And so often we need to actually not only use the supercomputing resources, but also develop more efficient computational models that will actually scale very well as perform at the same level of accuracy. So we don't want to really sacrifice accuracy, but at the same time, we want to develop computationally efficient models which will allow us to actually get into these micron length scale and microsecond time scales. And so that is a big challenge. And so what we do is to develop more efficient force fields. We take a lot of guidance from the first principles. So we use a lot of training data set from electronic structure, and then we try to actually bridge the scale between these atomistic and electronic length scales. So the idea is to actually have the speed of classical potentials with the accuracy of electronic structure calculations. The other area of interest is integrated imaging. So we are interested in trying to integrate the coherent X-ray diffraction, which is a technique to look at lattice strains in microcrystals. And as I will point out, there are several similarities between the CDI technique and the molecular dynamics. The information that you can get are complementary. And so the two can actually be used to push the resolution down to nanometer. So currently, the coherent X-ray diffraction limits, the resolution limits are, it can go down to like 10 nanometer. For the intensities which we have of the X-rays. But a combination of MD and CDI can really allow us to even look at 1 nanometer or sub-1 nanometer resolution. So that's an area where we are working with Tom Peterka at MCS and Ross Harder at APS. So we have an integrated imaging LDRD on trying to combine ultra-fast imaging with MD and use data analysis to actually tie the two. And we also do some code development. So we are in, interested in implementing some of the reactive force fields which develop on, you know, through this program called SIMOX, which is basically simulation of oxides. It's a code which we are developing. The time and length scales for materials modeling methods, so this is just focused on using molecular dynamics. So we can go all the way from picoseconds. So this is an ab initio MD simulation that we did for recent work on tribology, just looking at how molecules break down in a catalytic surface on top of a catalytic surface. So using electronic structure, you could also get a diffusion pathway. So you can get energetics and you can get dynamics, but the dynamics is typically limited to picoseconds. Now you can also look at classical molecular dynamics, look at reactive simulations. So something like a growth of silicene on silver can be simulated using empirical potentials. Now you can go to nanometer length scales and nanosecond time scales. And so you can really model the vapor phase deposition and growth of these two-dimensional structures. So all kinds of growth processes which basically span the nanometer length scales and nanosecond time scales can be accessed using these kind of classical molecular dynamics approach with empirical potentials. Again, you can look at things like aqueous corrosion, where you can have these green-colored atoms are chloride ions, which are attacking this oxide layer that is there on top. And so you can understand how the process of degradation of these metals or metal oxides actually takes place in a corrosive environment. And the underlying reaction and the dissolution of these metals can be studied using these so-called reactive molecular dynamics, where you are now trying to model the bond formation, the bond breakage phenomena within this molecular dynamics. Again, the length scales and time scales that are accessible are in the nanometer range. Now you can really push it by defining a coarse grain model. And so we are working in this direction to develop coarse grain models, which basically are, make the both the spatial resolution coarser, so you group a certain set of atoms and then represent them by a coarse grain bead, and so you have less degrees of freedom, but you gain significantly not only in the spatial domain, but also in terms of the time. So one of the limitations of molecular dynamics is that you have to use femtosecond timescales. So the coarse-grained approach, because you are not treating vibrations of atoms, you can go to 10 femtoseconds, 50 femtosecond time steps, which allows you to now go into microsecond timescales. But one of the common problems with coarse-graining is that you lose the accuracy that is often associated. So more often than not, what you when you go from these electronic structure ab initio MD to coarse grain models, you lose a lot of in terms of the accuracy. You gain in speed, but you lose in accuracy. And so what we are trying to do actually is to gain in speed without really sacrificing the accuracy part. And so I will actually go through some of these representative examples. So we've been working in the area of tribology, trying to actually understand what kind of mechanisms are there, what kind of friction laws are there at these interfaces. And so we have an example where the computations guided the development of a new kind of lubricant. So that was the graphene on a nano diamond in sandwich between a diamond like carbon and steel, which is a very common interface that is used in most most of these automobile engines. And then the next one is, next example is design of clean lubricants. So the base oil, which we typically use in our engines, has a lot of harmful additives that are added to it. And so this work basically takes advantage of catalytically converting these olefins into lubricating films, which basically eliminates the use of the hazardous additives that we actually use in our engine oils, but it also actually lowers the friction coefficients. So it performs better and it is environmentally friendly. And so I'll actually go through that example as well. And then I will go through some of our work that we do in terms of the force field development. So I'll briefly go through what the force fields are. And so there are two areas. One is the energetics, the other is the dynamics. And so I'll briefly go through the energetics and dynamics limitations of existing force fields, and how are we trying to bridge the electronic structure and the atomistic scales and and go beyond that atomistic scale, even hitting micron length scales and microsecond time scales. And so we develop both reactive and non-reactive models. And I'll briefly touch upon the modeling analysis and the ultra-fast imaging work that we are doing in trying to integrate molecular dynamic simulation with coherent X-ray diffraction, and then give some future directions and perspectives. The tribology area was attractive because it is a huge energy problem. We all know that the cars which we drive consume a significant amount of fuel, and most of the dissipation is through these mechanical energy dissipation. And so it can be either through the cooling or the exhaust. And this portion is purely lost as through the friction. And the 38% that we lose can be either through transmission, brakes, air drag, and tire. So there's a lot of fuel loss that is happening because of friction. And we can gain by coming up with new forms of lubricants and by coming up with new kinds of materials that can help reduce friction. So it not only saves the energy, but if you can come up with either materials or coatings or lubricants that reduce these emission of toxic gases that are currently there, it would basically help in not only reducing the friction, but also making a more cleaner economy. So we use these atomistic models to not only gain an understanding of friction, but also try to understand how different are these laws of friction at the nanoscale compared to at the macro scale. So there are empirical relations which exist at the macroscopic scale, but whether those empirical relationships are really valid at the nanoscale is something which we can test using our computational models. And at the heart of it all is the search for new materials which can eliminate friction and lower the fuel consumption. And so we discovered this phenomenon called as superlubricity, which basically means that the friction between two sliding interfaces drops to near zero. This phenomenon was never seen at the macroscopic scale, but what we observed was that using a combination of nanodiamonds and graphene, you could in fact see this phenomena under dry conditions at the macroscopic scale. And the computations actually played a key role in not only explaining, but also in basically designing these kind of materials for achieving this phenomena of macroscopic superlubricity. And so why is it important? Because, you know, if we look at the gear paths, typically after millions of cycles, it would undergo a significant wear. So a lot of effort in the automobile industry is to actually look for new forms of lubricants which can allow these engines to actually cycle through millions of times without really undergoing any noticeable wear. So we basically all want our cars to drive for, like, you know, 400,000 miles, 500,000 miles. But, you know, more often than not, if it's an American car, it breaks down after 100,000. If it's a Japanese car, then, you know, it goes up till 150,000. So there is a lot of effort which goes into reducing the wear between the engine parts, but also the aspect of energy consumption is important. So there are these searches for identifying new kinds of lubricants. And so one of the lubricants which our experimental collaborators were interested in was looking at graphene. And so initially, they actually came to us and they said, we have made this very good observation where we actually see that the friction coefficients are low. They are not super low, but they were actually around 0.04. And they said that, you know, all we do is we have graphene in between a diamond-like carbon, which is basically amorphous carbon, and then an underlying silicon dioxide substrate. And they said that, you know, we see this very low friction. It is not super lubric. And at that time, we believed that super lubricity at the macro scale was not even possible. And when they actually came to us, they said that, you know, we were working a lot in the area of corrosion. So they said that, well, something is reacting and it is causing this low friction, so we would be really interested in understanding what is happening. And so my postdoc actually said that, well, you know, let's just not trust these guys, let's just simulate this, and we will see what happens. And so he ran the simulation setup. It did not have this nano diamond in the beginning, so it just had this diamond-like carbon. You had the flake, graphene flake, and then there were these multi-layered graphenes, and the silicon dioxide is not shown here, but there is an underlying silicon dioxide substrate. And so when he ran these simulations, what he found was that these flakes actually scroll over and form tube-like configurations. And when he actually looked at the friction values really dropped. It dropped to almost like 0.004. But the tubes were not stable. So under the load that the diamond-like carbon or this amorphous carbon actually exerts, the tubes would actually fold onto themselves. And so the friction coefficient at that point would actually again jump up. When that would happen, if you average over time, the average friction would be higher, but the instantaneous friction would actually drop down to very low values. Now, we then figured out that if there was a way of just stabilizing these kind of scrolls, then we can, in fact, have a very stable superlubricity. And in fact, the choice of nano diamond was because the force field that we could use in the simulations would not have to change if we use a carbon-based material. So we decided, let's actually go with diamond. And when we actually did this, there were a lot of energetic considerations. We showed that it was, in fact, possible for these graphene to actually scroll over these nano diamonds and then remain stable, since the nano diamond was always sandwiched, was inside the scrolls, so it would never let the scroll actually collapse onto itself. And when we calculated the friction coefficient between these interfaces, it was always in the 0.004 range. So the frictional force essentially did not exist between these interfaces. So then we decided to try it out in the experiments, and when they tried it out in the experiments, indeed, there was actually no real fluctuation. It was a very smooth variation down to 0.004, and this is actually macroscale superlubricity. Now, there's a catch here. This was all done at the nanoscale, so you just have one graphene patch and one nanodiamond that is scrolling. In the experiments, you have several of these actually. You have several of these nano diamonds and graphene flakes. So there is an ensemble, and there is a collective effect which is taking place. And so we really wanted to understand that, you know, if at the nanoscale this scrolling phenomena is leading to a significant reduction in friction, how does it work when it actually, when you have many of them? And that's where we needed the supercomputing resources, because now we wanted to really understand how do these actually interact with each other, and how do these graphene flakes actually scroll collectively? What we did find was that even at the when you have an ensemble, as long as you have a threshold of these graphene flakes scrolled over nanodiamond, you can see this phenomena of superlubricity. And indeed, some of the TEM measurements which they did afterwards showed these kind of scrolls in the wear track, which actually confirmed whatever we saw in the simulations. And to understand why this scroll formation is actually causing this significant reduction in friction, there was already a paper which spoke about friction laws at the nanoscale essentially depended on the contact area. And what this whole process of scroll formation is doing is that now it is dramatically reducing the contact area. So if we do an estimate of how many atoms are in direct contact when the scroll formation takes place, they're 70% lower compared to what you start with. And this 70% reduction is a huge reduction in contact area. And this and the fact that an amorphous carbon substrate provides an incommensurate surface. So by incommensurate, it means that it does not have any predefined lattice. And so energetic considerations will tell you that if it is an amorphous substrate, then it will always tend to have a low friction. And so it was energetically favorable for these graphene flakes to actually slide, but the reduction in contact area basically pushed it towards the super lubric regime. And so that, the combination of the two, this huge reduction in the contact area by almost 70%, basically pushes this initially high friction towards the super lubric. And so it happens when the collectively almost 60 or 70% of these flakes have scrolled over nanodiamonds. So this immediately tells us that there is an optimal density of these graphene and nanodiamond that you need to add to actually achieve this super lubricity. If you add too many, then they will actually tend to agglomerate. And so agglomeration effects can actually affect what you see. So we could see in the simulations also that the density of these flakes matter a lot. So what this basically does is that it opens up this whole new area where 2D materials can now be used as lubricants. So, and there are new 2D materials that are emerging every day. So every 6 months, there's a big paper which will tell that we have either come up with a silicene or phosphorine or germanine or stannine. And so there are new 2D materials that are being synthesized, and most of them can actually have interesting lubrication properties. And so we can see through the simulations if these 2D materials also perform as well as, say, graphene. And we can explore the mesoscopic friction law. So there are laws of friction at the nanoscale, and then there are some empirical relations that exist at the macro scale. But nobody really understands how these actually translate from the nanoscale to the macro scale. So that is an area of interest where we can use these so-called ensembles of different nanoparticles and try to understand how the friction behavior translates from the nanoscale all the way to the macroscopic scale. And so there's a huge material space to play with. And then one of the things which I did not cover is that this super lubricity is extremely sensitive to humidity. So if you have water, it basically prevents the formation of scrolls, and that basically suppresses the super lubricity. So that's one of the reasons why I'm here. I'm not a millionaire yet, because this thing doesn't actually work under any practical condition. So this work basically is of a little bit more practical significance. So this basically is our work on tribocatalysis. It's on carbon-based lubricating films from the base oil or the engine oils which we use. This work just came out last week, is concerned with understanding how we can convert this so-called liquid lubricants that we traditionally use in our engines into coatings or into films that can actually not only lower the wear, but also get rid of these so-called additives. So the additives industry is a $10 billion industry. And the role of these additives is to actually provide this so-called solid film in between these sliding interfaces. So when you have an oil and these additives, the additives perform the role of providing a solid film, which basically prevents the wear and then lowers the friction. And a lot of, so if you go to an to do your oil change, you would notice that they actually charge you a disposal fee, because the disposal of these additives is not trivial. And so a lot of it is basically, you know, first you have to add these additives to actually perform better, and then you have to dispose them. So it's an environmental hazard which people are aware of, and there is a lot of interest in coming up with environmentally friendly so-called hydrocarbon oils. And so what this work basically shows is that you could use these kind of catalytic coatings, and you could basically eliminate all kinds of additives that are currently used and still get a better performance, and you could generate an operando lubricating film. So the catalytic action can really form these so-called solid tribofilms, which can actually eliminate the friction. And that is the catalytic coating that was used by our collaborators, experimental collaborators at the Energy Systems Division. So they used copper molybdenum nitride coating on steel. And then they found that, you know, if they use this coating, they get a low wear. And then if they don't use it, they get a high wear. And then, you know, if you actually use this kind of an oil with additives, then you actually end up with a coefficient of friction that is fairly high. You see reduced wear compared to without the additives, but still you get a lot of wear. And so typically what happens is the experimentalists have an observation and they come and then they ask you to explain it. And this is where we actually started thinking about this problem. And so when they gave us the information about what the coating had, the coating had several copper-rich regions within them. And so you have this composite coating, which has copper and which copper-rich regions. So there are grains of copper that are embedded, basically, in this molynitride film. And so we knew that there are some atomistic scale processes that are causing this friction reduction. But we were not very sure about what is happening because this whole system is really messy to treat with. So what we did was that we started doing ab initio molecular dynamics just to understand what is happening to this oil when it actually interacts with this so-called composite coating. Again, the beauty of these simulations is that you can isolate. You don't really have to treat a composite coating. You can actually look at copper and molynitride alone. So when we actually did these olefins, which are these hydrocarbon chains on molynitride, we found that molynitride surfaces are basically inert. They do nothing to these oils. But if you actually take a look at the copper coating, you can then start seeing that the copper actually starts breaking down these olefins into smaller chains. So there are these white atoms which are hydrogen. So it dehydrogenates and then it actually breaks down these olefins. And this process happens only at the extreme conditions that are prevalent in friction. So if you look at sliding interfaces, locally the temperatures can actually shoot up to as high as 1,000 Kelvin. And the pressures that actually are exerted at that tiny nanometer length scale can be as high as gigapascals. So it's a highly non-equilibrium process. At these conditions, suddenly copper starts acting like a catalyst and it starts to actually break down these kind of oil. And this, like I said, can give you information about what is happening, what are the elementary steps that are involved in bond breaking and bond formation, but it will tell you nothing about the nanometer length scale processes that are taking place. And so we actually used what is known as a reactive molecular dynamics simulation, where you can model the chemical reaction within the framework of classical molecular dynamics. So we took the system which they had in the experiments. We took copper, and then we actually put the olefins, which is basically a mixture of different hydrocarbon chains, and then we did the simulations under the conditions which are typical of a tribological interface. And then if you see, the reactive force field captures not only the key steps that are involved, but it also shows how these olefins, which have broken down, they recombine to actually form these kind of diamond-like carbon films, which are known to actually provide a very good anti-wear and lower the friction. So now you have this copper surface, which can actually catalytically convert the base oil, the oil without any additives, into a solid lubricating film that can now be used for providing protection against the wear and lowering the friction. So if I want to summarize what are the sequence of events, you have your initial configuration with this hydrocarbon. There is a dehydrogenation step, and there is a backbone scission, which is the breaking of the carbon-carbon bond. And then when we did these classical reactive MD, we could see that you can actually form these diamond-like carbon films. Now, the advantage of this is that Every time these nanometer thick diamond-like carbon film actually wears off after an extended period of time, the underlying copper can again catalytically convert the base oil into this film. So it's kind of a regenerative film which can be provided on demand depending on what kind of, like whenever the original coating actually wears off. And when they did the experimental characterization of their tribofilms, indeed they actually saw these kind of black debris, which basically corresponded to these diamond-like carbon shapes. So they even found carbon-like onions, which we also found in our simulations. We also extensively looked at other composites which they had, which did not work. And so they had looked at things like vanadium, iron, molybdenum, and their composite coatings. What we basically found was that the formation of the tribofilm was very important. And so the propensity to form this carbon tribofilm was dependent on whether this underlying catalyst would actually form a carbide. So although vanadium, iron, molybdenum are also excellent catalysts for breaking down the olefins, they themselves would tend to actually react with the underlying oil, the oil that is broken down. And so they would form these so-called carbides, which basically would not provide any protection against, because now you don't have a solid film to protect. And so the simulations then suggested that you should have these combination of copper and the molynitrite or vanadium nitride. The purpose of vanadium nitride and molynitrite was to actually provide mechanical support. And so that was their main role in these composite coatings. So copper is inherently very soft material. And the combination of molynitrite and copper basically ensured that the soft copper is not really worn off during the initial phase before it actually produces this lubricant. After the solid lubricant is produced, the friction between the sliding interfaces is very low, at which under which conditions there is actually no wear that takes place. I'll now move on to these force field development effort which we have currently in our group. So we are trying to actually develop new kinds of reactive force fields which will allow us to bridge this gap between electronic structure and atomistic length scales. So I've been talking about these molecular dynamic simulations, and I'm pretty sure most of you actually are not really familiar. So molecular dynamics is basically a technique where we are trying to, where we solve Newton's equation of motion applied to point masses such as atoms. So if you look at this, it's basically force equals mass into acceleration, and you have this interaction term, which is your potential that describes the interaction between the atoms. And a lot of effort actually goes into developing new kinds of potential that can describe the interactions between the different atoms. So there are various algorithms to propagate the system and get the forces. It's all dependent on how accurately you can actually describe this force of interaction between an atom I and atom J. And so irrespective of whatever algorithms you have to actually propagate the system or the thermostat or the barostat, the most important thing in all molecular dynamic simulation is your ability of the force field to describe the interactions. And so traditionally, force field or potential functions were based on some empirical forms, which were based, again, parameterized on some quantum mechanical approximations, or they were parameterized on some limited amount of ab initio or experimental data. And more recently, you have these so-called reactive force fields, where now you can actually describe the charges environmentally. So rather than having fixed charges, which was what was commonly used until a decade back, now you can actually describe now you can allow the charges on these atoms to fluctuate anywhere between zero and valence value. So by doing that, you can actually incorporate polarizability and the ability of these atoms to either form or break bonds depending on the local environment. And so that is a big step in trying to understand reactive interfaces. And these kind of interfaces, like I said, span through energy, corrosion, biology. So there are a lot of different applications. And if you want to really look at interfaces at these micron length scales and processes that typically span from nanosecond to microsecond and beyond time scales, we need the next generation of force fields. And so this is an attempt towards that. And if we take a look at just the existing force fields, and if I take a lithium-silicon system, this is the relative energy of a few configurations that were sampled in this, so lithium in various sites within a silicon lattice. If you look at what is known as a modified embedded atom potential that is commonly used, and if you compare that with DFT, you can see that there is a lot of scatter. Ideally, they should all be lying on this straight line if the potential were actually good enough. But given this amount of scatter, clearly there is a lot of room for improvement and coming up with new kinds of force field. Again, the second thing which is important is that you are never sure about what the dynamics, how accurate your dynamics is that is predicted by your molecular simulations. Currently, the nanosecond timescales are very, very difficult to probe using experiments. But with the advances in characterization techniques, it's not too far for us to actually look at these nanosecond timescales. But then there is no guarantee that the force field, the predictions that it is making, is actually correct, because we are not explicitly parameterizing it against forces that are actually derived from the first principles. So that is one of the steps. So if you actually take four different force fields, and if you want to look at this transformation that is taking place of a polymer, a thermosensitive polymer, from a coil-like to a globule-like phase, you can see that all of these four different force fields will predict the same equilibrium configurations, but their evolution is actually completely different. So you, at this stage, are not sure which one of these force fields is predicting the correct dynamics. And so none of these force fields were actually parameterized, keeping in mind the forces. So that is an area where currently we can improve upon. And so there, we have effort going on in that direction. Again, if I just want to actually compare the speed, you can see that if I take 152 atoms with 512 electrons with an electronic structure, it would be like 2800 core seconds. And if I take a very simple Buckingham type potential, it's like 0.2 core seconds. So there's a four orders of magnitude in compute time that is different between these electronic structure and classical potentials. But of course, you sacrifice a lot of accuracy. So our goal is to combine these flexibility and accuracy that is there of electronic structure calculations with the speed of classical potential. What we are doing is that we use an extensive data set that is derived from first principles, and then we use optimization techniques, both global and local minimization, to actually fit our either predefined functional form, or we have also few ideas on just doing away with all these predefined functional form and instead using basis expansions to fit the coefficients. And we also are looking at schemes to improve these charge transfer or the ability to describe the bond formation and bond breakage, and extensive cross-validation of these models to make sure that whatever it is predicting is correct. And so we looked at a variety of different test systems. A few of them, and so these are the different postdocs who were involved, Badri, Alper, Fati, and Lei. And each one was looking at a different system. Badri was looking at dimensionality effects in gold clusters, primarily looking at catalysis. Alper and Fati were looking at oxide systems, again for catalysis, photocatalysis application. Lei was actually looking at organic molecules in solvents, mostly towards the soft matter side of things. He was a postdoc working with Benoit Roux, who was a co-PI in this project. And our basic force field fitting framework is that you have all different kinds of interactions, and then you can either have fixed charge or variable charge depending on whether the force field is reactive or non-reactive. So the first step is model selection. You have to choose the functional form which will describe the interaction between the different atoms. Then the second step is to actually generate a DFT training data set. So you can use either dimers, trimers, or we can use clusters, or we can use some surfaces. And so things like elastic constants, surface energies, those kind of things are for a variety of different polymorphs are thrown in and for different configurations. And then we use the so-called two-stage optimization. So we first start off with a global optimization, like genetic algorithm, to arrive at a good set of initial parameters, and then we do a local minimization to actually then get the best set. And so these test systems, basically, if we take the gold case, we actually generated thousands of configurations of these different gold clusters. The problem here was to actually understand how do small gold clusters transform from a 2D, which they exhibit below 13 atoms, to a 3D structure, which is, and they have a diverse geometry as a function of size in this small small number of atoms or small cluster range. And their catalytic activity is a strong function of how their structure looks like. And so there was a lot of interest in trying to understand this transition. Again, iridium oxide is also a very interesting catalyst material, and there is no force field for iridium oxide, so we were the first ones to actually develop a force field for that. So in terms of model selection, we basically come up with a force field functional form. So in this case, for oxides, it's well described by these Mohs plus QEQ type of functional form. For the gold, there are several, like, you know, Sutton, Chen, Gupta. Basically, these are all different embedded atom type of models which have been improved over time. But they have all been fitted for bulk systems. So one of the first things which we did was to try and see whether they actually work for nano clusters. And our training data set typically comprises of a lot of different configurations that are, again, we use genetic algorithm for sampling these configurations and their energies. So you have DFT energies for the thousands of different configurations. That's your training data set. And then you are trying to parameterize your force field to actually reproduce those different energies and for the same configuration. And so that is basically your objective function. This basically just shows as a function of generations how the GA actually evolves. So we can see that, you know, GA actually does a lot better than random sampling. And this is how your energy landscape typically looks like. So we do a GA to actually come closer here, and then we do a local minimization using simplex to actually then get down close to the actual minimum. So that is typically what is the algorithm that is followed. So this summarizes what I've been saying. This we have an DFT training data set that is energies and structures. Then we generate a random population of possible parameter sets. And then our objective function is basically a weight times the difference between the DFT property and our potential generated property. And then we square that. And then we select the n fittest solution, perform genetic operations, and see if it has converged. And then these operations are carried out. And now there are different variants of this. We can even do a local optimization in between. And then one of the challenges which typically plagues this force field fitting community is how do you actually choose these weights? There is no real rule for choosing the weights for different properties. So if you, for example, have elastic constants, lattice constants, there is no predefined rule for actually selecting this. So people generally play around with the weights and see if they actually can come up with a good set of parameters. And so one of the ways to actually overcome that is to just use a multi-objective. So you define two different objectives. So you can have your elastic constants and your lattice constants, and then you can do a multi-objective fit. And so you'll basically come up with a set of parameters, and then you can choose which one actually is a compromise between the elastic, the errors in the elastic constant versus the errors in the lattice parameter. And so that is one of the things which we did. In this case, in the gold clusters, when we tried out the existing potentials, they were all bad. So they all predicted that the 13-atom gold was actually globular, whereas it is supposed to be planar. So the energetics were off in this case compared to DFT. And so when we reparameterized with a new functional form, so this is what is a hybrid bond order potential. So it has both short-range interactions and long-range interactions. And so this crossover between the short range and long range actually takes place at a particular cluster size that enabled us to actually describe not only the planar structure, but also the globular structure. And if we compare the energetics with DFT, we can see that we have a very good agreement. So the parameterization, in fact, gave us very good for this functional form which was chosen, it gave us a very good set of parameters which described the DFT energetics pretty well. We were not only able to predict the global minimum that the DFT predicted based on a DFT genetic algorithm optimization of this Gold 13 cluster, but we were also able to predict all the different diverse geometries. So not only the correct transition that takes place, but several different geometries which were predicted by our reparameterized force field were actually in line with what was experimentally observed. So existing force fields actually predict the wrong structures. So this was a kind of a major development. Now, when we actually showed this to our division director, he was very interested in the machine learning aspect and the fact that we are now trying to use big data in material science, come up with new force fields. But then he looked at the system and then he said, gold, well, few atom clusters, who really cares about it? And it's actually true, except one or two people at Argonne, maybe nobody really cares about these kind of catalysts. These are not really stable clusters. It's very difficult to synthesize them. And there are very limited application. So that motivated us to actually look at a system which we are all familiar with, that is water. And one of the problems here was that, you know, if you thought gold was actually well studied, water has been studied extensively by not just the soft matter community, even the inorganic community, actually. So it is one of the most common interface. Aqueous interfaces are one of the most common across, whether it's inorganics or soft matter. And so if you actually look through literature, there are at least 50 different water models that already exist. And so if you really want to enter into this area, there has to be something which we can actually do. And what we found out that there is actually a lot that can be done. Because if you take a look at this, there are 50 different water models, but none of them actually can predict the melting point and this location of this density maximum. So water actually has an anomalous behavior. We all know that ice actually floats on water. And the reason is that water exhibits a density maximum at 4 degrees centigrade. And so the volume, the density actually initially increases and then it decreases. And this kind of a behavior is not trivial to actually predict for existing force fields. And then you have the density of ice in the supercooled region. And this is the experimental values. And we can see that, you know, these are all the existing force fields. So my postdoc actually, when he made this, he said, this TIP-3P, which is one of the most extensive models that is used, he said, this is not even water. This is Pepsi or Coke. And so what we did was that we took, again, we followed the same procedure. We took the best performing atomistic model, and we generated thousands of configurations. And then we actually took a terse of formalism, which basically borders short-range interactions. We just thought that, you know, it would be nice if we can play around with just short-range interaction because it would help us gain a lot in computational efficiency. And we did the parameterization, and wherever the TIP-4P model was deficient, we supplemented it with experimental data. And then we were able to come up with a new force field that actually not only predicts the correct melting transition at 273 Kelvin, but also is able to describe this whole density anomaly and the density of ice all at the same time. And this is a movie which is actually a microsecond long movie of heterogeneous nucleation. So we already introduce a nuclei and then we watch how this nuclei actually grows. And this is supercooled water. So this is water at 240 Kelvin. This simulation over a microsecond time was done in less than 3 days of runtime. If you were to use an existing model, which is not as accurate, but is the best one, say TIP-4P or TIP-5P, it would take you 6 months to actually do the same calculation. And so in terms of computational efficiency, we are gaining a whole lot because we are coarse graining our model. So each water molecule is actually represented by a coarse grain bead, and we don't have any electrostatics. For these kind of phenomena, electrostatics really do not play a significant role. And we also limit ourselves to short-range interactions. And so we are able to actually gain in time. We are going at 20 femtosecond time steps. We gain in space. And overall, we gain almost like three orders of magnitude. And we, because we have trained our force field against the experimental data and against the extensive TIP-4P data, we're able to actually retain the accuracy of TIP-4P, but we gain significantly in terms of the speed. One of the problems which we wanted to look at is that the process of homogeneous nucleation of ice has been extensively investigated in literature, but nobody really knows how these grains of ice actually form. And so whether it is in our freezer or in the upper atmosphere where the supercooled water actually leads to crystallization of these ice, people still do not understand how we grow from a small nuclei to these grains of ice which are actually in centimeter or millimeter. So we all know that there are several nucleation events which take place, and then these actually is so-called polycrystalline ice forms, but nobody really understands how it actually consolidates and grows into this big chunk. And so this trajectory is a microsecond long trajectory and of an 8 million atom simulation box. And this was run on MIRA using our force field. And so we were homogeneously able to nucleate ice, because now you have a big system, and so nucleation is a stochastic event. If you run very small simulation box, you have to run several of them to actually observe one nucleation event. But if you run a large box of water, then the probability that somewhere a nucleation event will take place is much higher. So we were able to not only nucleate, but we were also able to grow this kind of grain. Now the next step was to understand how this actually transforms into a big crystal. And so we actually ran it even longer at a slightly higher temperature, which is typical of the annealing temperature. So this is at a slightly higher temperature, 260 Kelvin, still below the melting point. And we can see that now there was a dissolution. There is a dissolution event which actually takes place. You can see the white one is actually amorphous ice. And so the grains actually dissolve first into an amorphous ice, and then they recrystallize. Now, if you notice, these blue regions are not hexagonal ice, which typically forms, so the ice which we have at the most stable form of ice is hexagonal ice. But this is actually cubic ice. And then people have been saying that there are these stacking disordered ice, which we actually naturally form in our simulations. And how this, and people know that the ice which forms in the supercooled region is actually cubic. But we are able to directly show using our simulation that the ice which forms is there is very little energetic difference. So there is a kinetic barrier in going from cubic to hexagonal phase. And the consolidation of the grains is something which we are naturally able to actually capture in our simulation. And this is of importance because the grain size of these ice actually dictates a lot of different phenomena, from the glacier sliding to their optical properties when snowflakes actually form. A lot of it is actually dependent on the grain size. So people still did not understand how these grains actually form and consolidate. So that is a big area of interest. Again, from climate change, global warming, people want to understand how the pollutants are impacting the nucleation and growth of these ice. So those kind of timescales were inaccessible to molecular simulations, but with this kind of water model that we have, we can now start looking at those kind of phenomena. So this is a big step in that direction. And one of the things which we are now trying to do is to actually do away with these so-called known functional forms. So we don't want to limit ourselves or the physics that is being described to the choice of the functional form. So if you search through literature, there are several different functional forms which are available. To basically just eliminate that, you can describe your interaction between the atoms in terms of basis functions. So these are like cosines, exponentials, Bessel's function, and combinations of those. And so as long as you have an overcomplete basis set, you can basically fit to an extensive data set and come up with coefficients. And so now this is a more unified framework, more like the electronic structure where you have a Schrodinger equation that you keep solving for the different materials. And there we have resorted to techniques like compressive sensing, so a sparse regression technique to actually fit these kind of forms to large DFT data set of energies and forces. And so far, based on some test data set which were developed from our potential, we find that there is a lot of promise in this direction. So this is one of the direction which we are going towards. And the move is basically to create this kind of a workflow where the user just specifies the choice of functional form and gives a training configuration, and then he can have an optimized set. So right now, force field fitting is a very laborious process. There are very few groups that are actually involved in force field fitting. And if you talk to these groups, they will tell you that one force field will actually take like 5 years. And we want to actually reduce and shorten that time frame and basically make it more user-friendly. And so anyone who has a training configuration and a form of functional can now actually come up with a force field. So we are working towards that direction with Mike Wild, trying to actually incorporate this in Swift. The other program that we are that I am involved in is modeling analysis and ultra-fast imaging. I would just quickly go through this in the interest of time. So we are trying to connect molecular dynamics with coherent X-ray diffraction through data analysis. So in coherent X-ray diffraction, there is this problem of phase retrieval. So you have intensity data. And what you do is you keep going back and forth between the reciprocal space and real space till you actually get a high fidelity data. So typically between these, there are thousands of configurations and multiple random starts that are needed. What we are trying to do is to now guide it through molecular dynamics. And coherent X-ray diffraction and MD are not very different. It gives spatial resolution down to 10 nanometer. It can only image crystalline structures, so no chemical reactants or products, no solvents or ions. MD, on the other hand, can actually give you full atomistic information, and it can do hundreds of nanometers, so it can intersect at the point where coherent X-ray diffraction can actually probe. It can provide a picture of all of the aspects of the system, so you can look at ions, ligands, gas phase. So the combination of two actually has a lot of potential in gaining, in getting a lot more information than a CDI or MD alone can actually provide. We believe that MD is the ideal technique to actually complement CDI, and there are a number of different problems that we are actually looking at, from catalysis to electrochemistry to looking at the dynamics of growth to structural dynamics, where the strain maps actually change when you actually irradiate a particle with the laser. There are different workflows that we are working on. So the forward workflow basically means that it is a comparison made in real space versus a comparison made in reciprocal space. So you can simulate your system using molecular dynamics with all the new force fields that we develop. And the simulated trajectories, the positions of the atoms, the velocities, the forces, can be used to actually reconstruct the diffraction pattern that you can actually compare with the MD simulation. So we had a test case where we looked at a nanocatalytic activity. So we were looking at ascorbic acid degradation on gold, and we did basically both CDI, and we looked at the mechanism by which it lattice strain is in gold is induced by ascorbic acid. So while CDI could give you the strain information, CDI could not tell what is the ascorbic acid doing to the lattice. So the molecular dynamics came in handy there. It could tell us exactly how the ascorbic acid was breaking down and the hydroxyl was adsorbing on the catalyst surface and then leading to strain in the lattice. And to actually match the scales, we took the molecular dynamics forces, imparted into a more continuum model called finite element. And this structure was directly imported from the reconstructed image from the CDI. And when we actually applied the MD-derived forces, we could see a very good match between the CDI and the strain map and the FEM-derived strain map. So now we can actually make directly comparisons between the length scales that both the CDI and these simulations can access. So given this, the move is now to go towards atomistically informed CDI. So the idea, again, like our force field, is to generate a huge training database because we can do all these MD simulations in parallel. So we can create a lot of different extended defects and a collection of different point defects. And we know that these calculated patterns are different. So each one will have a different signature. We can create this whole database. And so when one does an experiment and comes up with this diffraction pattern that is a combination of one or more of these defects, we can then start to use machine learning techniques to decouple what are the kind of defects that are actually contributing to this experimental diffraction pattern. And with that, we can gain information now about these so-called corrosive processes that are taking place. What are the kind of defects that actually develop in these material interfaces? So the two actually can be combined. You can overcome this limitation of CDI. So currently it is limited to 10 nanometers. You cannot really see any defects. But the combination of two can now enable you to actually probe and get down to less than 10 nanometer or even a nanometer resolution, something which is actually a part of the APS upgrade. And so in the meantime, before the upgrade happens, we can actually get a combination of MD and CDI to do the job for us. There are rapid advances in high-performance computing, which have now enabled mesoscopic simulations with atomistic precision. So what we have now is that we can do these so-called reactive simulations of materials interfaces with millions and billions of atoms easily on these big computers. But the accuracy of these force field or our ability to describe these interactions is still a major bottleneck. And we need more efficient and elegant ways to actually bridge the gap. And so the predictions have to be accurate and computationally efficient for us to be able to make any kind of predictive design. Our move towards this so-called basis expansion technique to get a more flexible form of force field is a step in that direction, because now we believe that, you know, with all these optimization techniques, if you have a more flexible form of the function, and if you can train it against an extensive data set of training configurations, you can really have a force field which very well describes and at the same time is computationally efficient. So with that, I would like to acknowledge all the postdocs, all of my postdocs who have actually done this work over the years, ALCF Catalyst, all the collaborators with whom I've been working, and our experimental collaborators as well. And of course, the high-performance computing resources that are provided by ALCF, NERSC, and elsewhere. And with that, I would like to thank you all for your attention and would be very happy to answer any questions that you have.
In such basis ansatzes, you always have the problem that you want to keep the number of basis functions low and still gain a good accuracy of the function itself. So did you in some way quantify the effect of the choice of basis functions you are using, or was this actually was the choice of basis function motivated by the uncertainty?
So we know that the 12 and the 6 exponents are the one which dominate. So if you take an exponential, you should actually get back the 12 and 6 to be the more dominant ones. So those are the kind of tests which we have been doing so far. Now, we've also done some tests on DFT training data set. The problem is that once you have noise in the system, then it becomes a little bit tricky. And so if you have a DFT training data set, then we run into problems with the convergence of these. So it's a little bit tricky to actually extract the coefficients and get the current potential energy to describe that for the same system. For which, so for example, if Moore's type of functional form can describe it by training it against a DFT training data set, and if you actually use a combination of basis function, it does not naturally come out. So we are trying to figure out whether it's a limitation of compressive sensing or a sparse regression that we are using, or we need a more elaborate training data set. And of course, one of the problems is which functions are leading to uncertainty and all that. So it's a lot more complicated than and we've just started investigating. It's not anywhere close to the level of detail that you know I can actually give you a very concrete information on, like, this is what works and this is what does not work. It's something which we are trying out. Again, we have limited ourselves to systems like Gold, which are easy to describe. The two-body interaction, if you just want to look at Rij, expansion of those in basis function is quite easy. If you want to look at three-body interactions, then it becomes a little tricky. Once you have Rijk, then you either have to represent it in terms of dot products of ij, ji, ik. So it's not trivial, but if we want to do, say, bulk systems for which three-body interactions are not really important, then those are the kind of test systems that we are looking at.
But do you have any idea on how to do uncertainty quantification for this?
Yes.
This seems, all you were saying was uncertainty quantification is necessary.
Yes, all I'm saying is we have not done it, but this is something which we plan to do. We have not reached a stage where uncertainty quantification would be the bottleneck. Right now, we are still at a stage where we are still evaluating whether this kind of an approach is feasible for describing the system itself. So if you take a test data set, we can actually get back the potential form. But if you actually start taking a DFT training data set, which has more noise, then more fluctuations in energies, then we run into problem. So
my question is, when you are training in DFT, how many parameters in this system, and which kind of machine learning techniques are you using to figure out the parameter?
So that depends on the functional form. If it is something like a Tersov functional form, you're typically dealing with, say, 12 parameters. If it is something like a ReaxFF, you are dealing with, say, 50 or 100 parameters. If it is the basis functions, then you are dealing with thousands, because now you have the coefficients. You are basically trying to fit the coefficients. And so you could... not all the coefficients. So the thing is that most of these coefficients would be zeros, and so there will be only few coefficients which will be non-zero. But you are still actually trying to fit the parameters.
Something like you are fitting the function, though.
The fitting part might be intensive, but you will gain when you actually try to do the molecular dynamics, because you will have a tabulated form of potential. Those kind of things already exist. So once you have a description for the potential energy surface, then it is like any other molecular dynamic simulations. Then you are not really limited. So when you do the actual simulation, it is not really limiting you. It's only the fitting part which is actually more intensive. But that's a separate, that's quite independent from your actual MD simulation.
I had a question about your genetic algorithm. You said it was difficult to select the weights because you do not know how it behaves.
Yes.
So your objective function was looking like it is convex. So were there any constraints that prevented you from using the traditional convex optimization approaches? At least it should turn out to be quasi-convex.
Not really. We just decided to... So this is one of the off-the-shelf algorithm which we tried, and in terms of the selection of weights, the idea was that the error for each one of those objectives would be roughly similar, and so you know those were what was what were governing the choice of the weights. So as long as the contributions were similar, say for elastic constants versus lattice constants, we were actually okay with it. But what we found was that it was not converging. So again, I mean, I am not an expert in the optimization techniques, but there is a lot of improvement that can be actually made in terms of the optimization. So we are amongst the few who are actually using these kind of genetic algorithm. There are others who do one parameter search, and that is traditionally how the community has operated. So given that, I mean, this is one of the first few attempts at using things like genetic algorithm. There have been work which actually have developed neural network models for small molecules, but nobody's really done any dynamics with. So there are models which can describe the potential energy surface, but no real dynamical simulations have actually been done using those models. And so they've been limited to very small molecules just describing the potential energy surface. That actually was one of his questions, like what other techniques, machine learning techniques, are used. So in our case, you know, we just tried what was available, a GA toolbox that is readily available, and the idea was to just get a good starting point and then do a local minimization. And we ran into this problem with the weights, and our resident expert, Mike Davies, who, from CSE, he actually told us that, well, you know, just try out multi-objective. And we tried it out, and in some cases, we were able to see the Pareto, we were able to get a nice Pareto front to actually converge, and then get a set of parameters which was a good compromise between. And so this whole problem about selecting the right weights, how do you weigh defect formation energy versus lattice constants, for which there is no data, was actually alleviated. So that's where we are.
Okay. So like, I'm no expert in molecular dynamics, but just looking at the equation, it looks like a parabolic surface. So no matter how, like, what you weigh that parabola with, you're just scaling the parabola. The parameters that minimize that objective function should be the same.
Okay.
Right. I'm not sure.
We can certainly chat about this. I mean, it's something which most of our effort is actually in generating the training data set and in choosing the right kind of functional forms and in trying to actually go the basis functions route. The optimization and all so far we wanted to try, of course, we did not want to try the one parameter search, so we wanted to try something like a genetic algorithm. But there is a lot other, so we've been talking to Stefan Wild, trying to use his pounders, and so it works under certain conditions, then, you know, depending on the test data set that we have, so sometimes it actually outperforms all other local multi-start optimization techniques, but I would not say that we completely understand, you know, which one is the best technique or for a given data set. So that's something which we rely a lot on the collaborative effort with the MCS people.
Thank you.
Hi. So you are using the density functional theory to parameterize the MD simulation parameter. Yes. However, density functional theory itself include a lot of approximation. So how are you like making sure that you'll be getting the intermediate products right at the correct time? Since
I mean, it will always have the error, right? I mean, you are always at the level of DFT. Yes. So the DFT errors are the best that you can do. What we do try to ensure is that we are using the same level of theory. It's not like, you know, we will use a couple clusters and then suddenly use a PBE and then try to see that, you know. So those kind of things we try to avoid. But, I mean...
So one of the methods that we use is basis set correction, in which we try to remove the basis set error that we get from basis set. So have you tried, like, with energetic something doing like that?
For these systems, no. Mostly for organic molecules and others, you know, you... So if you're using Gaussian, for example,
yeah.
Then, I mean, it's a different approach itself. I mean, within, there are different kinds of electronic structures. So, I mean, we try to avoid a combination of different energetics from different levels of theory. So we try to be consistent. So if you're using PBE, we just use for the same for, the set of systems that we have.
And other question that I have is, you are using basically Morse potential plus charge interaction,
Coulomb for that interaction. Particular for iridium oxide.
Yeah. So the question is, ReactSF of itself include Morse potential plus charge interaction. So why not just try to change that one instead of using Morse potential and charge itself?
So ReactS actually includes a lot more terms than just Morse plus QEQ. And the computational cost of ReactS is way more than just a Morse plus QEQ. So if you want to really treat, if you want to treat a million atoms with ReactS FF, it's always going to be a struggle, even with all the resources which we have. And most of it is actually in the electrostatics. So in that respect, you know, if you have a Morse plus QEQ, it probably would be the same level of difficulty, but it's not really, the non-electrostatic part is much faster. If just Morse versus all the kinds of over coordination, under coordination corrections, which actually go with the ReactSF. So, what we are attempting to do now is to just parameterize ReactSF itself using some of our approaches to use the GA plus simplex. Because right now, the way ReactSF is parameterized is it relies a lot on the intuition of the original developer. And so more often than not, what happens is if ReactSF gives something which is counterintuitive, you get back to the developer, and the developer magically gives you some numbers, and then, you know, so that's how, so that was the original motivation. We want to do away from human intervention and driven by intuition. We want actually the optimization techniques to actually figure out what the best set of parameters should be. But that's not the case. Even when we actually do it, it's many a times we know what ranges to choose and all that. I mean, it's not like you can just throw it in. But it's still a lot better. So if you have a postdoc or a staff who has never done force field fitting before, right now our experience shows that, you know, we can get a reasonable set of parameters within 3 months, which if you ask people in the force field fitting community is a big step forward. It typically takes years to actually develop a good set of parameters. So.